So my name is Daisy Rosario. I'm a producer on an NPR show called Latino USA, where one of the many cool things I get to do is I'm allowed to cover anything I want about kind of the world of geek stuff, because I am one. I love these things. I personally grew up as a diverse fan, but feeling very alone in that. That has changed with the internet and as I've gotten older. In general, just meeting other people like me who love these things and, you know, very proud to love them, even though stereotypically that's maybe not what other people expected me to love. And so I do a series called Diversity and Geekdom, where I go and I interview people who work in various aspects, whether it's science fiction and fantasy writing, creating video games, comic books, you know, you name it. We're talking to cosplayers soon, things like that. And I let these people speak for themselves. I want them to do kind of their own first-person experience of what it's like. So when we talk to sci-fi and fantasy writers, we had people like Daniel Jose Older talking about the kind of feedback that he got on the work that he was submitting to different publishers. And when it comes to comic books, talking to fans about, you know, the characters that have really excited them, and talking to creators about what the feedback has been when they've made diverse characters and things like that. So today I wanted to talk to, you know, some creators, some artists and writers about the worlds that they actually build. And we're going to have two more panelists joining us shortly. It's a little Sunday morning, slow roll in, but I'll introduce them as they come. But right now I want to start with the wonderful people we have sitting up here on stage with us. And I'm going to start with Valentine De Landro. He's a co-creator of Bitch Planet. You're welcome. Alitha E. Martinez, you might know her work. She expects you to know more, you know, her work for WWE, for Batgirl New 52. We've got Amy. Let's give it up, guys. We've got Amy Chu. She's currently doing some writing for the DMC comic, among other work that she's done. Give it up. And of course, Greg Pak, who, you know, he's done a ton of work. I was just rereading Planet Hulk the other day, but also he has his own book out. It's a children's book called The Princess Who Saved Herself. There was a great panel on that yesterday. You should check it out. Give it up. So I really wanted to talk to people who do a mix of work for hire and their own work, because your abilities to kind of make things diverse, whether it's a character or whether it's the way the world looks, is going to really vary within that experience. So let's get started. I'm sorry, I'm having a hard time with this laptop because I don't need it and I'm short. As you can tell, it's hiding me. So let me just try to adjust to that. If any of you were here yesterday, there was a really, really wonderful panel on diversity for the Black Comics Month hashtag. It was really great. We had a lot of the same people on this panel now that were there yesterday. And I was listening to some of the answers that you guys gave, and I want to start with some of the questions that I thought of based on your answers. Greg, you said early in the panel that one thing that you heard one time that really stuck with you was the idea that making things even more specific, making the details of a character or world more specific, actually makes it more relatable. And I think that for a lot of people that probably sounds counterintuitive. They probably feel like, well, to make people relate to it, you've got to make it really broad. But why is it actually true that the more specific it is, and how has this experience played out in your life?
Yeah, I thought about that a lot because I've always wanted to tell stories that, you know, that reflect the world I live in, right? Spike Lee was a huge influence and inspiration to me when I started film school, and I remember reading the companion book he did to She's Gotta Have It back in the day. And I'm pretty sure this quote was in that book. It may have been in another book that I read about that. But somebody was talking about the hair oiling scene in She's Gotta Have It.
Yeah.
You know? And that is a scene, you know, there's a scene in there where Spike Lee gets his hair oiled. And outside of the African-American community, folks may not have known about that particular thing. But people totally understood exactly, everybody got it in the context of the story. You know, like, you understand the emotional context, the intimacy of that moment between those characters. There's a similar thing in a Peter Wang movie that I saw around the same time called The Great Wall, which was huge to me because it was the first time I ever saw second generation Asian Americans on the big screen. And it blew my mind. It's like, that's us. But there's a scene in there where one of the where the mother is cleaning out her son's ear, cleaning his earwax. which is, again, it's like a thing that, you know, outside of the Asian American community, that might not be something, you know, people have different kinds of earwax. I don't know if you know about that. I don't know if you want to get into that.
It's true.
It's
tough. I don't want to know about it more, but not at this moment.
But that moment, it's, again, it's this intimate moment that helps illuminate those characters, make them real, and it's just true. It's honest and true, you know? And so that, when you get very specific, things become real. If you made it generic, then nobody cares as much. You know what I mean? It's like the more generic, like if you think you can reach a bigger audience by making your characters generic, that's a fool's path. They'll never go anywhere. The only way characters live and breathe is if you give them as much as you can to make them as specific and real as you can.
Absolutely. I want to quickly introduce the panelists that just joined us. This is Edgardo Miranda-Rodriguez. Give it up for him. He's the editor-in-chief of Daryl Hanks Comics, or DMC. They have a booth really close to here, so you should check it out on the way out. But continuing with the question, I love that you, Greg, brought up the example of something that's related to hair, because it's a tiny thing. It seems like a tiny thing, but it can mean a lot to somebody. I remember just in watching the Tarantino movie Death Proof, there's a point where this character is very long curly hair. Mine's tied up, but I think you get a sense that I got a lot of curls going on. And there's a moment where the character with very long curly hair, somebody says something to her about her hair, and she says, "Oh, it takes a lot of conditioner." And it's such a tiny line. It's just a brief mention of the fact that you need to use a lot of conditioner, which is incredibly true. And it sat with me for days because I'd never heard anybody acknowledge that. And it seems like such a small thing, and I was already an adult, but it still really just stuck with me, that one line in this larger movie. The fact that seems so realistic to me meant a lot. So for anybody else, that question, what kind of details were important to you to put in as you either created your own work or in doing work for hire as you're fleshing out a character? I know, Ed, we talked about, I got to interview Ed in DMC for a story I did on their comic when it was coming out, about the level of thought that you guys put into the way the world of New York City looked. I think you said even that the graffiti on the trains is done by actual graffiti artists. Can you speak a little bit to how fleshed out you made that world and why?
The world that we fleshed out in Daryl Makes Comics is my world, our world. I grew up in New York City, I grew up in the South Bronx, I grew up during the evolution, kind of like the development, the birth of what would soon become hip-hop, right out of what was the gang era of the 1960s and 70s during the white flight era. White flight, meaning white folks left New York City because this shit got real. And now everybody's like, wow, New York City is fucking great. You know what I mean? So it was a different New York City, and we brought that into our comic books. My background, before I came into publishing, I was actually an activist. The safe word is community organizer, but I was actually an activist. I worked in the community, my majority of color, Latino, African American, and Asian, doing a lot of work to raise awareness around police brutality, social justice work, real superhero work. And that translated into actually developing a publishing company. And what we did with Daryl Makes Comics is similar to what hip-hop did in the early 1980s to the rest of the United States. We became very aware that the canon that exists, that Marvel and DC developed 60, 70 years ago, predates the civil rights era. Therefore, these characters are kind of like set in stone to be white and male. Now, our world reflects a different reality. Our reality is, I look to the left and to the right of me, and I see Latinos, I see working class whites, I see African Americans, I see Asians, everything from Sancocho to Kimbap. You know, that was our reality, and so we had to make that part of our publishing initiative. So we brought everything from real graffiti writers to actually add their unique style and art to our books, to even the characters that we developed. It was very important for us to do that. And it wasn't an actual conscious effort. It was organic. It's who we were. It's who we still are. And when we started doing these tours, and our book came out, and it's almost, the first printing is almost completely sold out. Our first book came out last fall. The overwhelming response we received nationally, even internationally, was, I see myself in that book. And it was mostly young women of color. Young women like Daisy herself, they said, I finally see myself in this book. And it wasn't just kind of like how Greg alluded to, it wasn't this generic character. They were very specific. This was this girl that we grew up with around the way. This was this brother that we grew up with around the way. And these were the archetypes that fueled our character design. And it's very conscious, because when you're creating diversity, know, when you have this kind of like real lens at life, and I guess me being an activist kind of like gave me that real sense, because I had to work with different groups and I had to work with different communities to create community. So if I'm going to get into publishing, I'm not coming from a complete place of fantasy. I'm coming from a place of reality, and I'm telling stories. And that's the most important thing. I'm telling stories to our generation and to the next generation, like my 11-year-old son, for example.
I remember when I, so I was going to do a story on DMC, so of course I get to see some of the issue before I would normally get to see it, because I've got to prep for the interview. And one thing, again, just these tiny details I think mean so much when you've been so deprived of kind of seeing diversity, and I said this to you, but just like the fact that in the kitchen, on the counter, there's like a can of Café Bustelo, which is like, that is the coffee that if you are Latino, or if you even just grew up in New York, like, you know, your family probably drank that, little yellow can is so familiar. So just like the little details of that, even if the character was white, I think if I saw something like that, I would go, I know this world, and I feel like this world understands that I exist as well, which is a big deal. Alitha, you've done a lot of work for hire. You're also doing your own work. And I wonder, you know, you are beholden to the script, as you were saying, but I've read some scripts, and, you know, some that are not describing every instance of a panel, so... You know, do you get to make little choices like, I'm going to make three of these heads brown in this, you know, in this panel, or, I mean, how does it work?
Well, it depends. It depends on, like, the time frame. A lot of time when I get it, there's not enough time left in the script to be very creative. And I find if the writer didn't put certain things in, then I don't feel as if I should add too much more than what's already there. I can't change the world from what's already built. I'm just the next one in line doing it, which greatly differs from my own work, because in my own work, I can slow that process down. I can go back and add all the little touches. You know, some people have, my hair is straighter, my hair is curlier. I can make that difference in the same set of brown people. But in a normal, you're just running on what you know, which is that basic body type that I learned to draw, and I need to draw it quickly, and I don't want it to look wonky and people to hate me and burn me in effigy every single month and say horrible things about me. So because I know, yes, you know who you are. And you know it. It says I don't want that to happen. You try so hard to make it look correct that you forget you're not actually making it diverse. And if, like, I got to work with Amy, who made this wonderful, built this wonderful world in just a couple of pages, that let me stretch and make more people, and I felt more liberty to put people of different skin colors in there, because she had added it to the script already, so it wouldn't look strange, and editor wouldn't say, you know, this is, where are we? No, she built a world that I can play with.
Gave you the framework, it was easy because it was set in Detroit in the near future, so you already kind of have an idea. And I did give you a lot of photographs, but, you know, the outfits that you came up with, everything felt very real, and I didn't put that in the script. You did that, so I was like, I'm so happy with that.
How does that differ for you, and then we'll jump in, Ed, but how does that differ for you, maybe from working on other projects where you're giving people a sense of a time and place and it doesn't maybe come off?
You know, when it comes down to, comics is a collaboration, right, between writer and artist. Sometimes the writer and artist is the same person. In this case, working with Alitha, I already had a sense of kind of her style, I guess, and it really varies from artist to artist. Like, I've had, so this was a story for Vertigo, and it came out, and it was just, I mean, people loved it. I did another story with a different artist, again, different world. This was set in the Bronx, and he was not from New York. He sent the artwork, and it was gorgeous artwork, but he made the Bronx all white. Okay, we need to have a little talk. Okay, I didn't have to do that with Alitha, but, you know, went back, I was like, okay, this is what a New York City bus looks like, these are the people on the bus, let me give you a whole bunch of photographs, you know, and he's like, oh, okay, I get it now, but these are the kind of the things you have to do, and when you're working for one of the big two with a monthly deadline, you don't always have that luxury, okay, and it is a luxury in some ways. I as a writer, need to make sure that artist knows, this is the world that we're trying to build. This is a real Bronx, okay? We need to fix this, you know. There needs to be some people more with street clothes and stuff like that, less polo shirts.
Do you want to add something in?
Yeah, I just wanted to add really quickly, because Alitha brought something up, and I'm actually working on a book right now with Amy, and even gender is, for me, is important to discuss when it comes to diversity, because artists are trained to draw a woman in a certain way. And right now we have a 13-year-old character, and I have to constantly remind the artist, she's 13 years old, and we intentionally made her 13 years old so that she would look 13 years old, you know? And I'm Puerto Rican, so there are a lot of 13-year-olds that don't look like they're 13, but this 13-year-old we developed is definitely supposed to look like a child, you know? And that even that, Amy and I discussed it, was like intentional, because we wanted to create a woman character that was actually, from the beginning, not to be sexualized. She's a hero. Not to be a sexual. She wears a track suit, and her track suit is not gonna go down to her cleavage. You know what I'm saying? It's gonna stay up because if somebody throws something at her, it's not gonna fall in her track suit. You know what I mean? Just had to add that.
Well, that's a good point in that I wanna make sure that we realize as well that when we are talking about diversity, I wanna be talking about it not just from a race and ethnicity standpoint, but also in terms of age, in terms of gender, in terms of, you know, LGBTQ issues, like, and the fact that those things would, you know, Greg mentioned, you know, the example that he saw in the Spike Lee movie, or maybe you don't understand the different ways with earwax in the Asian community, which I still now really need to learn more about. But if you have a character who, you know, I was talking to some people yesterday, actually, after the panel, some fans and other people, and the idea that, like, diversity is more than just taking a character and going, okay, this character is, like, gonna be black or Hispanic, and now I'm gonna make them brown, but they would still look the same otherwise. Like, their hair needs to also be different then. The way that they're drawn needs to be different, but also the reality of the world around them would be a little different if you are seeing their mother and father. And so if you just go, okay, the character itself is now this ethnicity, if you don't actually flesh out that world around them, is it actually diverse? You know, I mean, I personally, as a reader, wouldn't feel that was actually diverse. Valentine, you are working on something where you and Kalista got to really just create from scratch, you know, this whole world. Yesterday at the Black Comics Month panel, you said that, you know, diverse characters were the prime directive. How did you then think about, you know, the whole world you were creating around these diverse characters? You're going to want to get right up on that mic because this is a loud, loud room.
Hello, can you all hear me? Are we good?
Yeah.
All right. Sorry, what was the question?
So you make a great point of creating these diverse characters.
Right.
How do you make sure that the world you're creating around them as well is reflective of that and is, you know, fitting for who those characters are?
In this instance, I think it's a little different. The world we're building is a character in and of itself too. There's a, which if I say too much, I'm gonna give away too much, but It is based in a future where the media is being used to influence and make people conform to a certain standard. So in doing that, we're now trying to interject the characters, and most of the characters are specifically people of color, and we're putting them in certain roles, so you'll see it's really just to make that division to show that, you know, that it's not just people of color, but it's specifically women who are in positions of service and not necessarily the same station as the other men in this book, especially the white men. It's all for a message. It's all done intentionally because Kelly Sue and I are not subtle. We don't know subtlety. We flirted with it once upon a time, but not with this book. I think that this book is going to be everything that we pretty much wanted to ever say ever, and then kind of put it out there and not pull any punches. We're not out to demonize or sort of condemn anybody, but we are trying to make a point, and you can't do it with subtlety sometimes. kind of kick the mule in the head. So that's what we're going for.
Such a fog in my throat, sorry, I'm getting over a cold. As you do work for other companies though, if you do work for bigger, you know, companies and such, and you're, whether you're writing or doing the art, I mean, have you ever, like, had moments where you were able to, like, get a little reference in, or, you know, like, just put a little something in? Greg, I see you responding.
Yeah, I'll speak to that. We're more powerful than we imagine a lot of the time, you know? In comics, from the beginning, when I first started working in comics, a big motivation for me always with media has been to get different faces up on the screen or on the page, you know? So one of the first things I did, one of the very early things I did in comics 10 years ago, when I had the chance to create a new character for Marvel, I co-created Amadeus Cho with Taki Miyazawa. And, all right. Oh, Amadeus, blah, blah, blah. So we had been given a list of old Marvel names, like old Marvel superhero names from the 50s. And I picked the name Mastermind Excello, just because it was so over the top. And we made it into this super genius kid, Amadeus Cho, who gets into all the trouble he can get into. He has zero impulse control. And from the get-go, they were just like, cool. They're like, thumbs up, let's do it. I never, ever had anybody say, does he have to be Korean? You know what I mean? It never even came up. They were just like, sounds great, let's do it. And I've had that same experience time and time again. I mean, I'm constant. If I ever introduce a new character, it's usually going to be somebody who's different in some way from what you usually see. In fact, just last week, we introduced a new LL character into the Superman universe. If you know anything, if you know about Superman, a lot of the prominent people in Superman's life have the initials LL, Lois Lane, Lex Luthor, Lana Lang, and
Cool J.
Yeah, oh, Cool J. Tight.
That's the crossover with your comic, I think.
And so we just introduced a new LL. Her name is Lee Lambert, and she's an African American firefighter. I was kind of shocked looking back. This is the first African American woman in the Superman universe with the LL initials. But again, I was like, okay, here's this character. Aaron Cooter is my co-writer on that book, and we developed this character, and at a certain point we're like, let's make her an LL. Let's give her an LL. And I sent in the dialogue, and the editor's like, thumbs up, let's do it. You know, literally no pushback at all. And in scripts all the time, I'll say, this is Metropolis, let's make sure that it's a diverse group, you know, in the back, you know, like, if there's a crowd scene, there should be a really diverse group. Even in Smallville, we had a story set in Smallville, rural America is diverse, you know, like, America is a diverse place, you know, the world is diverse, so, but as a writer, just write it, and they'll draw it that way. Yeah. It's awesome. If you're an artist, draw the backgrounds, you know, like, if it's in a big city, wherever it is, you know what I mean? Bernard Chang is an artist friend of mine, and he used to talk about, like, he did a Wonder Woman story, and there was this alien, you know, Wonder Woman was having a thing with an alien, you know, an alien race, and he said, can I make them all look Asian? And they were like, sure. So he did, you know, but that kind of stuff is, we have the ability, even in work for hire stuff, to do this all the time. The world is open, you know, in a lot of ways.
Can I share my work for hire story just a little bit? Because it's actually interesting. I was doing another story for Vertigo, talking about this diversity issue. There is diversity, and there's just sake of diversity, right? So I try to make sure everything is as real as possible. Detroit is very diverse. I actually sent over statistics just to make sure, you know, the demographics of Detroit, you know, just so you understand. Like, I think it was something like 60% black. You cannot do this Aloha movie thing where all of a sudden, you know, someone's white, right?
So wait. Emma is Asian, though.
Right. You don't want to do that in comics, because, I mean, we're not casting. We're making these characters. So I like to make sure, not to be overkill, but I do want to make sure these worlds feel real. So I just work with an artist where she made everyone diverse, and I'm like, okay, I can't believe I'm saying this, but this particular scene is set in Wall Street in an investment bank. It's not that diverse. You gotta take the black eye out. I'm sorry. It's true. At a certain level, there is diversity within a lot of corporations, but only at a certain level. When you get to a CEO level, you can see that. Open up Forbes, you know. It's not pretend that we're so diverse in certain things. And that makes it real. I was like, we need to talk to the colors, you gotta take it out. because that's real life. I don't want to be fake diverse, all right? Let's be diverse where it makes sense and where it's inclusive. But this is a message that this is not a great place. This is not a diverse workplace. This woman is miserable in her job because it's not diverse. So, you know, so we had that conversation and we took the black guy out, so.
But that's an interesting point in trying to make the realism of it, especially, you know, with this character, you're saying that she's in a miserable situation. You want it to look like what you're envisioning is making the miserable situation in part. And I think, Greg, I'm glad you were able to speak to that, particularly with Superman, because that's the thing, like, you know, there's all these calls for diversity, and I'm so glad to see this conversation happening and to see it especially happening online, and there's so many really wonderful outspoken fans and people really speaking up and creators being supportive of that and doing that in their work. But nobody's expecting anyone to take Superman and make him something else, but that doesn't mean that characters around him can't also be reflective of what the world looks like. You know, you don't have to take Superman and try to change everything about him, but that doesn't mean he can't interact with characters that would be of other backgrounds.
Also, he ain't white. He's an alien.
Right. He's an immigrant.
Yeah, he's an immigrant.
No, honestly, he is an immigrant. And for what it's worth, you know, Gene Yang is coming on board to write the Superman book. So I've been writing action comics, and I think one of the reasons the character has always appealed to me is because he's an immigrant. You know, I mean, he was created by Jewish Americans, and a lot of people smarter than me have written a lot about the Jewish American experience and how that may have manifested itself in the creation of Superman, his backstory. But he's also, you know, he's bicultural. You know, he's a person who grew up, and found out late in life that he has a whole nother background. He passes, you know what I'm saying, which is interesting.
That's a
good
point.
I'm half white and half Korean, and if I'm with a bunch of Korean people think I'm Korean. If I'm with a bunch of white people don't think about it. If I go to a Jewish wedding, everybody thinks I'm Jewish. You know what I mean? But the passing, you know, that notion of Superman as somebody who passes is interesting. I mean, I'm sure that's one of the things that makes him interesting to me, or makes me kind of get him. You know, also I grew up in Dallas, and I moved to New York. Grew up in, you know, Smallville, moved to Metropolis. You know, but honestly, even that is interesting. Like, one thing about diversity too is that white is not a monolith. White people are just as diverse as everybody else. If you scratch the surface and go deep. I mean, some of my favorite characters are like Daredevil. You know, Matt Murdock, his, you know, Irish Catholic experience is critical to that character's resonance, you know? Superman is a, you know, white bread farm boy. You know, Clark Kent growing up in Smallville, like that's a specific experience that's totally different from Bruce Wayne growing up as, you know, the poor little rich boy. You know what I mean? Like, those are, you know, urban, you know, an urban rich kid. Like, those are, you know, that kind of variety of experience is also part of this.
That's a great point. I grew up in New York City. I had a lot of friends that were Irish or Italian. Their family is very different than the people I went to NYU with, for example. Like, it was like meeting a whole different culture that I wasn't used to.
Just comes down, I think, on a big part of diversity in fiction is just, it just comes down to good writing. Yeah. You know what I mean? Like, if you're going to write any character, you're going to dig deep, you know? And you get to something different than the generic thing.
I want to welcome another panelist, Kim Gaines. Kim, I didn't want you to be in the same little kind of tucked away corner as yesterday, but that's where we've ended up. Kim, give it up for Kim. She's the creator, correct me if I'm saying it wrong, but of a comic called Eventide. I tried to write it phonetically yesterday when you said it, because I do radio, so I have to write phonetically at times. Yeah, scoot over a little bit. And just to catch you up, because I want to make sure we get your voice in, and we're going to take questions shortly, so if you have any, please start thinking of them. You can start lining up whenever you like. But we're talking about the idea of diversity and how it reflects in the world, how just taking a character and going, okay, this character is going to be African-American or Latino isn't enough if all you're doing is just making their skin a different color and not actually making the world around them rich. So how do you think about that and approach that, bring truth to that in what you do?
For starters, I always try to make people
before I make a race. You know what I mean? I think a lot of times once you start developing who the person is and what they like and what they don't like and how they speak, all of that stuff, characters kind of build themselves almost. It's almost, and it's fun. It's fun to watch that process kind of go on in your own head. And then they just pop out and they are what they are. And then I think after that, as far as the level of realism, after that, after you know what they are and what they look like, you sort of go back and you research or you talk to your friends or you try to get other people's experiences so you can sort of color that character with those aspects. That way, again, that their culture is who they are, you know what I mean? It's absolutely incorporated. And then the other thing I think also is that sometimes it feels a little taboo to talk about race issues and things like that in comics. I want to bring that, you know what I mean? It should come up the same way that I might make a weird joke with one friend who might be black, or a weird joke with another friend who might be white, whatever. Bring that into it too. Make it funny. Take it head on. You know what I mean? Sometimes it's serious. Sometimes it causes problems. Sometimes it causes arguments. But at the same time, I do think that it causes more camaraderie. It really connects the characters in a different way. So that's what I try to do with culture and comics.
Well, you brought up research, and I'd like to pose that question to everybody. And then in the meantime, if anybody has questions, please line up. I'm going to throw one question out to these guys, and then we'll start taking your questions. Kim, you brought up research, and I was wondering, in terms of not just writing characters, that, you know, we have all diverse creators up here right now, in and of yourselves. Obviously, you're going to know a little bit about your own culture that you come from, but as you also try to reflect a diverse world, what kind of research do you do to make sure that it's reflective of either a place or if you're writing a character of a different background?
I'll talk a little bit about, I just did a story for Sensation Comics, Wonder Woman, set in Afghanistan, and it's a war story, and it's military. I have no background in military, but I wanted to make sure it was reflective, and I did a huge amount of research, because also I'm terrified about getting it wrong, you know? You don't want that kind of flack. So I did so much research. I looked at so much of on-the-ground troops, how people dress, ethnicity, gender. My protagonist is a Latina combat pilot, you know, and the response I got was, were you in the military? Because it felt so real. And I'm like, okay, I know I did my job then, because that's the kind of feedback I got. And I don't know if anyone here has served. I mean, literally, they were like, this is awesome. I'm passing it to my buddies, to my girlfriends. You know, because there are women who serve in the military. Do we see that represented anywhere? I haven't seen that. And I was like, this needs to be kind of a true story, even though it's a Wonder Woman story, right? But it's a true story, kind of, you know, because we're all Wonder Women, right? And I think that level of detail, I also have the luxury, again, it's a short story where I had lead time where I could do that kind of research, and Bernard Chang was the artist on it, so he got what I was trying to do, and it was perfect. So, but that's the kind of thing, as a writer, we have the power to do that. You know, we don't just have to go with cookie cutter, what we thought way back when, what the military looked like.
I think you said something interesting of like, well, you know, it's not real because it's also a Wonder Woman story, but I feel like that's something that you do see people that, you know, are detractors, if you will, or people that kind of are like, you know, get upset about the diversity conversation. They're like, this stuff isn't real anyway, so why does it matter?
No. It's very important, because actually the genesis of that particular story, I was talking to a classmate of mine who was a pilot in Afghanistan. He's African American. And we're talking about that. I'm like, dude, I need to do this story. Because we're not seeing that kind of thing.
What do you guys say to people when they say, like, oh, but it's all not real anyway? People can't fly, so it doesn't matter.
Well, I mean, what we're doing with Daryl Makes Comics is actually interesting, because it's fantasy, but then I actually have a real flesh blood man named Daryl McDaniels who's actually, you know, here. And it's a trip, because you could draw Spider-Man comic books or you could write Wonder Woman comic books, but, you know, she's not going to sit at your table at booth 1025, but DMV would. So for us, it's kind of like,
booth 1025.
It's a trip, but it is a reality, because, like, Daryl always says, for him, he says it in a playful way, he doesn't think comics are fantasy. And the reality is that if it were fantasy, we wouldn't have conventions, we wouldn't have companies formed on it. You know, if it was fantasy, nobody would be making money off of it and making careers off of it. So it is rooted completely in reality. If not, we'd be drawing like mouse-shaped organisms that don't look anything like human beings. We're obviously drawing it from reality. And even for this universe that we're creating, although I'm not the writer, as editor-in-chief, I have to cultivate a community of writers and artists and give them references so that they don't just look at, for example, urban culture as what we see now. I have to show them documentaries that predate, you know, the corporatization of fashion. You know, they go, look at Rubber King, look at Style Wars, look at Palante Siempre Palante, look at these documentaries that document New York City in the 60s and 70s, and this is gonna tell you what New York City was like. This is why New York City needed heroes. It's kind of funny to have comic books now, because that, you know, given how New York City looks with all these beautiful like high-rise multi-million-dollar condos, does the city really need superheroes, or does it need more condos, you know? So we, our universe is like, let's make a New York City that really needs heroes, you know? And that's kind of like where we draw from.
Yeah, I think the answer, all good fantasy has to have something that resonates with you as a reader, as a viewer. You have to recognize something about that story in yourself, and I think that's why it's important to have diversity and have, there is a little bit of reality. Even watching Game of Thrones, right, there's a little bit of dynamic, personal dynamic that's in there that you understand, so, and that's what makes a good story.
Okay, Mr. Jackson said, you know, we are making a living off of this. This is our jobs. I get that kind of duality all the time because people come up to me and first it's, did you draw this? So I have to validate that point. And even within my career, because like a lot of them spoke, they have all this freedom. I've never experienced freedom in what I do. I just do what I'm told when I'm working for industry, which is totally different. I had to go outside of industry and start creating my own stuff and put out my own ones. And now I'm hearing, well, those characters are never so because they're a little bit too everything, or too this, too much of that, or they're not superheroes. So I'm finding that I don't experience like the freedom. I feel like I've heard, I like it, I love it, now change it so often that comic books don't feel real to me in that sense. It becomes my job, it becomes how I support my family, but the love I felt when I drew my first Iron Man book left before the issue was over. So I had to then come outside of it and start to do my own, stand up on my own 2 feet and go, this is what was inside me. I'm not actually from New York. I'm not actually from anywhere. I understand the word passing because I pass every day. People can hardly tell what I am. You hear, oh, I don't hear your accent anymore in speech therapy. It smooths it out. You can pass for an American. You can pass your family that way. And I feel I've been doing that my entire career. So it's only just now that I finally said, you know, I'm creating my own things. I've created my own universe. Let me try with it just to make sure I don't end my career with the same feeling I had when I began it. Like, you better conform or there's nothing.
You said, I like it, I love it, now change it. And that is something I've heard from a lot of creators, especially when I was doing interviews to fantasy and sci-fi novelists. I spoke to N.K. Jemisin, Nalo Hopkinson, and I believe I already mentioned Daniel Jose Older, and they all talked about how that was the feedback. Oh, your writing is great. I love what you're doing, but change it. Because the editor didn't relate to it, or the publisher didn't relate to it, and not understanding other people would relate to it. Yeah. So let's get to our first question. If you could tell us your name.